were doing this, we began in 1969, and it was a completely different atmosphere in America. A few of the people that listened to our music understood what our message was. They might like the music just on a melodic basis, but didn't understand what we were singing about usually. And it took another 10 or 12 years before other groups like us, like Death in June, Current 93, and other groups started doing similar type of music to us a decade or more after us. So we were kind of there at the beginning. During the 1960s, I was involved in conservative revolutionary politics in America. And I'm not just speaking in ideological or intellectual terms. I was a member of an organization which was an armed revolutionary group. And somehow I survived, and by about 1969, everything we were doing fell apart. And that's when I turned to music, into art. This was my new vehicle of expression. And I had decided at that time that the Western civilization had died. About 1945, I believe, our civilization had died. And what we are experiencing today and what we have been seeing is its decomposition, which follows its death, where all the atoms begin to careen off in crazy directions, incoherency begins to appear in our culture. And I thought that at that time that we had to reestablish something of the old ways of our people again, so that we can maintain ourselves as Europeans and Euro-Americans and so forth, and that even if our civilization was dying, it was time to begin to build a new civilization out of its ruins. And our first attempt was in the music genre that we formed. And what we were trying to do in our music and in most of our early songs was to reassert the legends of our various ethnic European people. We wrote a six-part piece of music that runs to about 33 minutes, and each part of it is devoted to a particular ethnic section of the European people: Slavic, Italic, Hellenic, Arthurian for the English people, and the French, and Etic subject matter for Germanic and Scandinavian peoples and so forth. So we were raising a banner, you know, that it was time for us to look at ourselves again as we live in these ruins, in these times, and come back to our true selves for once. And our true selves, our true gods, our true traditional cultures and everything. And that this would be the basis for a new civilization arise out of the bad times that we are in today. So, it was 1969 in America. Apocalypse was in the air, an impending feeling of doom. The multicolored dreams of psychedelia had begun to fade, and for those of us who had crossed its rainbow bridge, there would be no turning back. The prevailing order of things, the sterile dogmas of organized religion, the Protestant work ethic, the open-ended pursuit of material things, these and a host of other similar assumptions, formerly taken for granted with simple-minded acceptance, now came into question, were scrutinized, dissected, and exposed for the frauds we felt them to be. But what were these mainstays of our civilization to be replaced with? The music of the 60s had served as a simplistic prop for the newly emergent counterculture and its ill-defined aspirations. But what had gone wrong? We had all sung along with "All You Need Is Love" and joined the chorus of "Strawberry Fields Forever" in joyful defiance. We had turned on, tuned in, and dropped out. But where would we go from here? The much lauded creativity of freedom of this counterculture from its hedonistic sex, its drug-induced visions, day-glow posters, tie-dye clothing, massive musical gatherings, and a do-your-own-thing philosophy had run its meteoric course, burning itself out. The early 1970s were to be its anticlimax, as runaway inflation, growing corruption, and cynicism began to penetrate most segments of American society. American boys were still fighting and dying in America's second no-win war in Asia. The secret police, by way of their COINTELPRO operations, infiltration, agent provocateurs, frame-ups, armed raids, and assassinations had been successful in rendering any revolutionary activity, right or left, ineffective and null. Tricky Dick was our chief administrator and about to live up to his bad name. Psychedelics had begun to be replaced by other addictive drugs such as heroin, morphine, and cocaine. The recording industry was about to experience its lowest margin of profit in decades. The psychedelic head shops began to fold up business. The so-called Age of Aquarius had grinded to a halt, and along with it, an entire generation was left floundering in confusion and despair. The 1960s was a tumultuous decade, to be certain. It was a 10-year period jam-packed with portentous events. And gazing back nearly 30 years later at that decade, one is struck first by the sheer madness of it all. The second thing that becomes obvious is how much those events of that decade have defined the remainder of the millennium right up to our present time. The following 40 years seem in many ways to be little more than a millennial continuation of the 60s, not simply in a chronological order. The threads of certain events seem to have tenaciously woven their way through the warp and woof of time and continue to be dominant strands in the fabric of the present. We are still reeling from the ripples of repeated shockwaves which that decade sent forth across the waters of time. It was the decade of the Cold War, a term coined by British novelist George Orwell. The 1960s were to witness a heightening in Cold War tensions that would peak with the Cuban Missile Crisis. Most of us were young teens at the beginning of the 60s, had more or less been living with the ominous threat of nuclear extinction hanging over our heads for more than a decade. I'm sure this real fear, though seldom discussed or spoken of, must certainly have had some effect upon the character, beliefs, and perceptions of the generation that grew up under that period, who were impressed by that period. Certainly human history as we know it is a long, almost monotonous series of wars, invasions, annihilations. What, however, makes a qualified difference between past times and the nuclear age is that nuclear warfare is an imposing threat for any average individual to respond to in any normal human way. In the past, one could trust in their own strength, courage, weapons, and wits to survive. But suddenly, a generation was confronted with a threat for which the only answer was to dig a hole in the ground and cower, pray, and don't come up till they tell you the coast is clear. How powerless, how dependent upon factors far beyond one's understanding and control. How emasculating in effect. Nuclear war, for all its technological wonders and wizardry, effectively relegates warfare to a level of abject nihilism. Gone is any sense of heroism, courage, or honor. Even dying and sacrifice have lost all meaning. Nihilism is in fact negation of any belief or certainty, and nihilism of the Cold War can logically be seen as a major contributing factor to the spiritual malaise that would ensue. The advent of atomized or nihilistic philosophies and feelings in any civilization is a clear indication of an impending spiritual crisis. How could it be otherwise? For those of us growing up in the 60s, the assassinations, race riots, missile crises, Vietnam, lower spectrum guerrilla warfare, and a plethora of other outstanding and outrageous events were sure to feed the already festering spiritual crisis that had been gaining momentum over the preceding 100 years in the West. America, with its economic prosperity, was long overdue for the spiritual crisis to arrive. The events of the 50s and 60s would effectively kickstart the crisis. The spiritual void would soon serve as a ready receptacle and medium for various cultic formations. So, at about 1969, everything kind of grinded to a halt. What seemed like it was the Age of Aquarius coming turned into a rather dismal affair as economic problems began to enter in and otherwise. I personally began to view the problems of the West not so much as a political problem, but as a spiritual problem. And it is the spiritual within a civilization or culture which is the hub. Politics, art, poetry, everything you can think of that are external expressions of a culture have their beginnings at the hub, which is the spiritual sense within human beings. And if you lack all spiritual sense, you have nothing to offer in the way of creativity or civilization any longer. So I decided that our crisis was essentially a spiritual crisis, and that was pretty much shown by the number of Indian gurus coming over to the West, all of these exotic religions coming in here. And I began to look at this, and I saw Christianity as a religion which was also a foreign religion, which had been imposed upon our people 1,000 years ago, in one form or another. And it seemed to me that we shouldn't be accepting more foreign spiritual things into our lives, that we should go back to our own ancestors and understand what they believed in. This isn't to ignore other religions or spiritual paths in the world. You can learn much from them, to be sure. But in essence, it's a case of us coming back to our own selves, rediscovering who we are. That will give us the rooting and the strength to face the future and to do something with that future creatively. So I was one of the three primary people in North America who independently formed what today has become known as Odinism or Isatru, which is the Norse Germanic folk religion of Odin and Thor and Freya and so forth. And so I worked at that for about 25 years in trying to generate that spiritual path. And over the last 30 or 40 years, it has deepened and broadened in its essence. Many other people came along and helped with the movement, like Edward Thorson, Stephen Flowers and his rune books. He did a lot of research. In the beginning, we had to refine everything, and there wasn't a lot of materials left about our own people. The Germans, the English, they all had a thing of identifying with classical civilization, you know, with the Romans and the Greeks. But when it came to their own ancestors, they pushed it out of the way. That was savagery. They did not want to be in any way connected with their own people. You know, so even though there was plenty of books on classical mythology, it was hard to find a book on Germanic or other Indo-European spirituality at the time. Today that has changed, and it continues to change exponentially each year. More and more research is being done, more books. I often thought that the study of language was as important as archaeology, the archaeology of language. Because going back to language and knowing the etymology of our language is to begin to understand the psychology of our ancestors, because their psychology is innate within the language and the meanings, the root meanings of our language. Because after all, language is little more than expression of our thought processes. So I think we can learn more from language, from the study of languages, be they current or archaic, than we could with the spade, you know, digging up artifacts. I mean, you have the artifacts, something to look at, but it tells you nothing about how the people felt, how they thought, what their perceptions of the universe about them were. But language does, you know, a very detailed study of language. So that was one of the things that I tried to institute among some of our people. One of my good friends became a Germanic language expert, several of my friends, and began to really study the language and its roots. I had the pleasure of listening to languages like Gothic being recited, beautiful languages. Gothic sounds like Latin. It has the beauty of the Latin language to it. And that was one of the things. So we started the spiritual movement along with the music movement. And it went into other arts and other crafts, and today it's the larger heathen or folkish movement across the Western world. And I've been very happy to see heathenism arising in places like Lithuania, Russia, Poland, all of the Eastern Bloc countries that were under the oppression of the Soviets for so long. And if anything good came out of the Soviet experience, it was that it cut the Christian churches back. And then when the people were once again free to do their own thing, many of them returned, instead of Christianity, returned to their native beliefs again. And once you come back to your own native beliefs, you don't live in a sense of guilt, a sense of sin anymore. It's a more balanced outlook on life. The heathen outlook on life is not antithetical to science. We're not going to put any Galileos in dungeons because they find some new information. We will be informed by that information, and we will ingest that information, and that will become a part of our world outlook, you know. Whereas with Christianity, when it came in, science became the enemy of Christianity. And Christianity became the enemy of science. And this was a wrong way to go, because science should, in fact, inform religion. It should bring back facts, you know, I mean. But religions oftentimes with their doctrines and dogmas, they don't want any facts. They want to just keep going on with whatever they believed in before. And then science was antithetical to spirituality and religion, which is a bad thing, because that means you take all ethical and moral conscience out of the scientists. So I was recently reading a book by Dr. Albert Hoffman, who was the discoverer of LSD. And the book wasn't about the trips he took or anything like that. There's a whole chapter in there which is really significant, where he makes a case for science and spirituality to once again come back into coalescence. And in that sense, his book is kind of a bridge between the scientist and the spiritual world, which is really necessary. I mean, horrendous things like vivisection, using animals to test things on, you know, with no conscience or anything. Poor dumb beasts, you know, we are the shepherds of this world, not the people here to prey upon us and use it for our own ends and purposes. Animals have a right to their life just like we do. And with that in mind, you know, if the scientist was taking a spiritual approach to things, these things would not be going on. There would be a conscience. He would be looking at what he is doing and what he is pursuing and asking all the salient questions of where is this going to? For instance, with genetic engineering, particularly when it gets into the areas of cloning, like they did with the Lucy sheep over in England some years back, a decade ago. Okay, people complain about the population burst in the world. The world's becoming overpopulated. So then they're going to try to make babies in test tubes. And this is like totally ridiculous, but this becomes a quest that the scientist pursues without any thought of where this is going to go, what those children are going to be like who have never had the bonding with a mother or a father figure in their life, you know. What kind of human beings will this create? People without consciences? People who have no loyalties? People who whose only loyalties are to the state or something? Or they'll make supermen, genetically, who will overpower the rest of us. That's the other possibility. And I've never been given a good reason why genetic engineering in the realm of cloning and everything, what the purpose or the goal in all this was. If it was space exploration, okay, I might understand it. It might take time to create life by the time you get across the vastness of space so that you would actually have people to colonize that other planet or whatever, you know, because the distances would be too great for the mariners who were originally taking off as adults. But outside of that, I could see no justifiable reasons for these things. And that's the problem with science, you know, it's lost its way, its spiritual sense. But with heathenism or paganism, there should be no rupture between the scientific and the spiritual. They should go hand in hand towards bettering life, essentially, and bettering human beings. So that's some of the things that I stressed in my writings and other things. So we formed this religion, which is growing really fast, and everybody within it, I can assure you, is really normal, healthy-minded human beings who do not have guilt or anything. We follow simple, basic ethics that I think everyone in this room could agree with. Ethics of loyalty to family and to home and to country, to your kind, industriousness, willfulness in accomplishing tasks without being lazy. And these are all things endemic to our people from the beginning. You know, this is what made us great. And if we can't save Western civilization per se, Perhaps out of this wreckage we can create a new culture, a new civilization, better than the last one, because we won't be burdened with alien religions on top of us or anything, expecting of us things that we are not innately and genetically constituted to be a part of, you know. I mean, to have a religion of a stranger folk, of another people, is to expect you to be like them. And much of the colonization that the West done was horrendous, where we went into countries like Tahiti, which were paradises. The people were happy. They weren't bothering anybody. They weren't warring against anyone. And we would go in there. First of all, the conquerors would come in, take their women, give them alcohol, syphilis, ruin their society, and then the missionaries come in, and it wasn't enough to take their resources and everything else, they're going to steal their very souls out of them and destroy their native cultures. Now, the Tahitian is a Frenchman, is expected to be another Frenchman. But of course, he's a Tahitian, and he can never be a first-class Frenchman. He'll always be a second-class Frenchman, just like a Frenchman would be a second-class Tahitian if he tried to be a part of their native culture. So everywhere that we conquered and imposed ourselves upon other native people, we did not improve them. What we did was to make them second-class citizens within our world, because they could never rise to our particular, because they weren't us. It was not innate to them to be us. So, and likewise, conversely, we are not constituted so as to follow the edicts and the ways of other people, you know. We follow our own ways. So I have sort of acted as a shaman over the years, and so much, you know, a shaman tries to help people find their souls. But I haven't done it so much on a one-to-one basis, but on a massive scale, you know, by addressing larger numbers of people through writing and, you know, ways other than one-to-one. Because it seemed like the problem was so enormous that if I were to take each person one time and sit down and talk with them and explain much of these things to them, that I could never get beyond a couple thousand people or something in a lifetime. But I still do that too, you know, in addition to the larger thing. So by way of our music, by way of art that we create, poetry, craft work, and everything else, these are expressions of our people. And hopefully those of us can one day scratch through the veneer of what's been painted over on us and find our own selves and our own culture once again and become ourselves, first class. Because we're not trying to be somebody else, we're just trying to be us, you know. And I see this as a pan-European thing, not any one group. I care very much for Europe because Europe is my motherland. North America is my fatherland. But this is where my civilization comes from, this soil. And it's very important that Europe maintain her people and everything, because America could be lost. It could turn into another Mexico. But as long as there is Europe itself, you know, this is the epicenter of our culture, our people, our way of thinking and feeling. So I never want to see that lost here through unlimited immigration and everything. And it has nothing to do with hating other people or anything, but these are our lands. This is where our dead are buried in the ground who have sacrificed for our tribes and our people. So that's the thrust of pretty much what I've been doing for about the last 50 years, is trying to help this emergent folk culture among our people. And I see it here among a lot of you folks, and it's very heartwarming. I see a lot of people wearing Thor's hammers and other symbols up there that are of our people and getting back to themselves, you know. And it's a healthy pathway, a healthy spiritual pathway that will be fulfilling once you make the journey. So our music was one part of it, but that's just a small part of it, you know, a cultural medium to express ourselves, essentially. And the great thing about it, this opens up a vast realm that each one of you can contribute to as craftspeople, using your eyes, your hands, your motor reflexes, your minds for writing and everything. I mean, no one need be excluded. Here is an area in which your creativity can come forth and continue for the rest of your life contributing to something worthwhile. That's worthwhile to you and to your own people. And that, so that's pretty much all I have to say about it. You know, I see the death of the West here, but that doesn't mean that we don't pick up and build in the ruins and form a new and better and more beautiful civilization out of it, a truer one, one that springs from the hearts and not from the head alone. So that's about all I have to say here today. I hope that satisfies your interest. If there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Was that
inclusive? No question to be floored?
You weren't going to read N finally?
What's that?
You weren't going to read N finally?
Well, my cousin Nicholas here, my counterpart in Changes, suggested I read to you a poem that I wrote back at the beginning of this. And it's called N Finally. And this poem was written in London. I had been down to Westminster Abbey, the big cathedral there, and I was walking around looking at things, and I noticed all these bricks with names on them, and it was the Poets' Corner. And then it was T.S. Eliot was in Westminster Abbey, his name. He was an American from St. Louis who gave up his citizenship and became a British subject. He became more British than British. Because the English weren't striving to be British, he was. You know, he was making a real protein thing to be so. And I began to think of his poetry, of the Wasteland, the Hollow Man, and so forth. And I think he was great poets, but at the same time, he was a rather ineffectual human being. Didn't have a lot of gumption, a lot of guts. His friend Ezra Pound was the one who was the poet as hero, who paid the toll for his poetry and his ideas, whereas Eliot sat back and, you know, was never affected too greatly by what he wrote. So I wrote a poem called N Finally, which is a polemical poem in parody. It's somewhat in parody of his poems. I didn't have his poems with me when I was writing this in London. I was just going from memory. And I answered some of the questions that were posed in his poems and so forth. So to begin, invocation. Make now, O muse, thy crystal voice. Sing strong within my soul. Forge hard the links which join my words in triumph's tune and passion's dirge. Grant me, O muse, your gift to gaze, thy lofty overview, and to grasp the flowing surge of time in each moment's interlude. Do I dare? Do I dare disturb the universe? Do I dare not disturb the universe as its... Wait, one second. Do I, as its hour of decision draws near? Do I, or you, or they dare refrain as the crucial junctions of the gyres coincide, evade the true direction we must take? For even amid the tranquility of one's cloud-swept summer day, I have witnessed wisps of white and airy clouds whirl into perfect place and form the image of our age across the sky's blue face. And there above the white sand, in diamond sea at dawn, these very eyes have stared transfixed in awe on Kali's deft and deathly dance of myriad legs and arms that move with sweeping godlike grace of perfect movement formed. The day grows old and time wears thin, and 10,000 years in the balance lie. The die be cast, will the curtain fall? Will twilight spread her cloak of raven night and swallow all? O son of man, whatever be, humble worker, king's descent, awake thy mind. Shake loose thy, awake thy eyes, shake loose thy mind. Make firm thy heart, for uncertain fate now beckons forth. Rumbles of Ragnarok, though distant, draw near. Even now the order of battle forms, and still the merchant tallies his gain and his loss. And still the priest with rusty nail hammers another soul to his cross. O dragon sleeping in blood of vein, awake from out that pulse-beat cave. Make manifest the forgotten fury of thy flame. Quench full thy fork-tongued thirst of flame. Do I dare to eat a peach? Yes, I dare to eat a peach and to spit the pit full force in the eye of an Anglican priest. Do I dare to turn? Yes, to turn I dare, to face the facts full front and to stare. Nor shall fatalism be my faith, nor shall church chapels be my hiding place. Nor shall starched white collars and tailored suits be my public face, nor limpid resignation be my guiding trait, nor bowler hats or interest rates, nor banker's hours and flat dry speech. Yes, indeed, I'll eat a peach, though April be the cruelest month, she ushers in the spring. Toward the future alone shall I direct my thoughts, leaving memory to rot. I shall go north in the summer, there to bury desire beneath a drift of snow, and I shall not sell cheaply my birthright for a published book of poems, or sever roots of kinship, ties of friendship, or of home. The failed hero, the Judas priest, the timid poet of stuttered speech, all flee the arena when the shots ring loud and wander lonely like a cloud. Then enter now the chosen one, son of the sun in the lightning's flash, who follows the spirit of his genes and the wisdom of his blood. Poet, yes, and shaman priest, warrior chief or harper king, Prometheus, fire thief, seeker, bearer of the holy light, pinioned high beneath the grim and ashen sky, first and last and sacrificed, champion of the endless fight. Too far ashore am I to hear the mermaid sea, but whispers on the wind bring their plaintive call to me. I need not guess, for I can say, airman's soul's roots clutch fast, the core of time now spent, its branches bud and broadly spread out toward the future tense. The fragments fit, mandelic images emerge as one, the ancient gods arise, brush off the dust of the past millenniums, and stride green earth again. What say the Norns in council seat? Shall Ragnarok begin? Or shall we lull them all to sleep and double on the fun? And in the end, the poem which does not speak, the song which is not sung, shackled in printer's ink, the time-worn words, verbal ciphers on the book's thin page, fossilized thought forms frozen in time, static in space, tinder for the final flame. And in the end, the vacant womb, the narrow mannequin hips, the empty arms, the barren breasts, all victims to a fruitless intelligence. And in the end, a literate mass of men incapable of thought, unwilling to act, whose souls are sold and bought, slump lethargic before the mesmerizing screen, lost in their video dream. And in the end, those hollow men, at fate's cruel call, reduced to an ash smudge on the asphalt street, an empty echo of the neutron's roar. And finally, this is the way the world ends. This is the way the world ends. This is the way the world ends. Not with a bang, nor with a whimper, but with the mystic words thrice whispered, rebirth, rebirth, rebirth. Been a pleasure.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Robert, may I ask you a question? I want to ask about the symbol of your band and the name of your band.
Oh, the band's name is Changes.
Yes.
We played last night at 10:30.
Yes, I know. I want to ask about the appearance of your symbol and the name of the band. Correct me if I'm wrong. I think you told us about Changes symbolizing the returning, symbolizing the way to a new civilization, which is returning to our roots.
Mm-hmm.
Am I right or wrong?
You're right. Yes, absolutely. Anyone else?
Yes, I would like to ask you a question. As I understand, you were talking about the neo-folk culture.
Yes.
And I would like to ask a question, what a real neo-folk man or woman what he or she have to do, which would help him to come back to the roots?
Well, reading will help you, attending events, and learning from people, you know, personally, listening to the lyrics of the words to many of the songs, will engender some insights into what I'm talking about. You know, the neo-folk has become kind of spread now, and some of it is overlapped into industrial music, black metal, and several other genres of music, but essentially it's all the same message with slightly variant vehicles of expression.
Do you think that listening to neo-folk music is the only way to go to that culture?
No, not at all. No, you don't have to enter from music. There's many pathways. You know, it could be scholarship, it could be study, it could be listening to people who know and are experienced in these things, who have been around for a long time, and have salient ideas to pass on to you. My greatest hope is always the young people. When we formed resurrected Germanic religion, one of my fears was that our own children, by the time we got too old to do it, would be right at that age group where they had three children, they had to pay a mortgage, a car payment, and they would be so busy right in that period of their life, that period of about maybe late 20s to 40 years old is the busiest time in anyone's life just about. You're trying to make ends meet, feed children, raise them. You have many concerns, so you don't have much time for outside activities. And I was worried that there would be a cessation of things. There would not be enough people to carry things forth. Mm-hmm. So I made every effort to bring in people in between the ages of us and our children. And that has worked, and we got some very fine people supporting us and working for our cause and so forth. And I'm hoping once again they will do the same thing, because now they're entering the point where they're having children and jobs and careers and everything that take them away from doing as much as they'd like to. So we're looking for that generation like you. I'd say you're about early 20s, about 22 or so. Yeah, that's the next generation we would like to bring into our cultural manifestation, you know, definitely. If you'd like to talk later, I'd be happy to, you know, talk to you personally.
So what would be the ways or methods to regain the knowledge of the past in order to integrate it?
You have to do a lot of reading.
Well, I think it's definitely not history or archaeology, but, you know, that knowledge is probably waiting for us to find.
Archaeology, yes, and more is being found today with all of the check that we have for spotting things, aerial views of things. I mean, if you just look over the last couple of years, an immense amount of sites have been found, cities that have been found in the Altai mountain range. That may have been Hyperborea at one time, you know, that the famed place may have been out in Siberia, you know, may have been the origins of our people or something. There's a lot of reasons to believe possibly that. Others say a Arctic homeland and so forth. But these things are not important things of where we came from. They're interesting and so forth. But at the same time, we are here now, you know, and this is the important factor. But whatever inspiration you can draw from the past, you know, strengthens you, makes you more rooted, makes you more within yourself who you are. It's a growing movement. I mean, even this gathering here has many elements of it in it, you know, of heathenism and so forth. So that's basically what we're promoting. There are organizations, and we've never made an attempt to put everybody in one organization, and only one organization is the true one. You know, like Christian churches, for the Baptists, the Lutheran is wrong. For the Lutheran, the Catholic is wrong. You know, none of these congregations get along. But we believe both in organized groups, but there's also individuals. And that's fine too. You know, you don't have to be a member of a collective group or whatever to learn and be yourself and contribute. And there are journals. Some of the journals are put out by associates of mine, like Chair, T-Y-R. Is a big, thick journal that was being put out annually. There will be another one. Three of them have already existed. They're a great place to get started on studying tradition and so forth. Hex magazine that comes out of the northwest of America is another magazine that has a lot of folkloric stuff, art, design, poetry, every kind of creativity going on. And my own group, I have a very small, not a large group, called the Tribe of the Wolfings. And one of the criteria that we have for membership in our group is that an individual be a doer, a maker, and a shaper, which is to say somebody that does something, that doesn't just sit around and talk about things. And among us, we have quite a number of musicians, artists, artisans, craft people, and everything else. So as a leader of this group, I practically don't have to lead anybody, because everybody knows what they're doing. They're all out there creating all the time, doing something, translating books, creating music, and so forth. So it's been a wonderful experience. And our group is sort of like a cultural cadre. You know, we feed into all the other Asatru and pagan and heathen groups. We're there to help them. When they hold a gathering, we go out and play music for them in the hopes that we can draw more people by our presence there and such. So we're sort of back. I become sort of like a Billy Graham of heathenism. You know, I don't have my own place. I'm not here to get you into my group or something. You know, I'm just here to spread this message largely to people and to assist all the groups that are organized groups in that, to give them whatever support I can do. This tour that we're on is a 10-performance tour here in Europe. The first one was last night. We have 9 more. Then when we return to America, we will be playing at Stella Natura, which is a big heathen musical event on the west coast in California, up in the Sierras. And then in October, we'll be returning to Pennsylvania to play for the Asatru Folk Assembly, which is one of the larger Asatru groups in North America, and we'll be there to support them. I'll probably speak there, and we'll perform music as well. So we go wherever these groups are. I'm good friends with the Odinic Rite, the Odinist group in England, which also has corollaries here in Europe in different countries, in Argentina and other places. So I support all of these groups, you know, most all of them anyway. There are a few that are off tangents from me who call themselves universalists. And these are people that think that people not of our kind can become members of this. It doesn't make any sense to me. A religion which is very close to the one I'm promoting is Shinto among the Japanese, which is their native religion before Buddhism. Now, I respect Shintoism. There's 11 or 16 different variants of it, and I respect it. You know, that's a native religion. But for me to become a Shintoist, or you, would be insane. Why would I want to worship the ancestors and the gods of the Japanese people? And I have nothing against Japanese people, but I mean, it would seem incredible, you know, to do that. And it would equally seem incredible if a Japanese person wanted to worship our ancestors. You know, I would look at that person askance and think there was something wrong with them, that they were mentally not quite right. So there's these people in heathenism and paganism that call themselves universalists, and they call people like me folkish Asatru. But I don't use the term folkish, because being folkish and being Asatru are the same thing, essentially. It's a redundancy to use those two terms. I mean, it goes with the territory, you know, altogether. You know, I don't have to call myself folkish. If I'm Asatru, I am folkish. There is no other way. So, you know, that's how we sort of operate, you know. And like I say, my group is more like a culture cadre, you know, with the arts, the music. We have sculptors, we have painters, musicians, quite a few very talented people. Some of them you probably even know have been here to play before, like Blood Axes, Walterfell, Marcus Wolf and Walterfell. He's a long-standing member of our group. He also is an editor of Hex. Michael Moynihan is co-editor of Cheer, the book magazine. So our people are always very busy, you know, promoting our ideas and our resurgent cultural dreams. So anyone else? Yes.
Europe has one big problem, and that's the European Union, which imposes all kinds of laws that we
I know.
Accept multiculturalism by law. If we oppose it, then we can criminalize these symbols.
Oh, I know, I know. They want to, in fact, what many, American, as well as the more so in Europe, they are using the same tactics against their own people that they once used against colonies. In other words, taking away their culture, taking away, they want to take every flag, every symbol away from you. So in this universe, you have nowhere to make that final stand with your standard there. You're lost in a void. They want us all as autonomous atoms careening around in a void with no direction home, so to speak, with no sense of purpose or who we are. We're just more workers on the world plantation, essentially. Oh, I understand everything you're saying there. I mean, to outlaw the runes in Scandinavia,
yeah.
I mean, these are written on the souls of the people. And to take this away from them, same thing in the United States. The Confederate flag has become a big point of conjecture. You know, the stars and bars. They don't want the Southerners to have this flag because that flag is their knowledge of who they are and their time and place. The Irish in Boston, they were trying to force them from taking down shamrock flags on St. Patrick's Day. They don't want anyone to have anything that you can call your own, that you can make a standard or a stand at. So if they take away all your symbols, it's sort of a lower spectrum war going on over symbols. It's a part of what Julius Evola calls the occult war. To take every symbol we have, every thing that grounds us, everything that gives us direction as to who we are and where we're from, they would like to take that from us and leave us with nothing, with barren souls, basically. Yes, very much so. I agree with you very, very much. And I'm very concerned about that. That's why I said I am very concerned about Europe, because Europe is where this civilization comes from. United States, Australia, these other places are just colonies. They're cultural colonies. And I'm an American whose roots go back to the 1600s. But my family never forgot Europe. Europe was a motherland. This is where we as people came from. This is where our culture, our language, everything came from. So I always call myself a Euro-American, not just an American, but specifically a Euro-American, because I identify with European culture, you know, and I don't want to see it lost. I mean, we have some great things in our civilization, the music of Beethoven and Wagner, and a million other things, the architecture, even the foods. I look at Europe, the bakery goods, for instance, flour, butter, cream, a little salt and sugar. And they made a million different types of pastries out of them, cakes. You know, I mean, but when you look at the constituents, it's like a handful of like five conceivable things that you're making breads and all these things out of. And when I come to Europe, you know, my God, in France and Vienna, all these places, all this wonderful pastry and cakes, and they're all made with the same essential ingredients. But the genius of the people has created thousands of different approaches to using them in that. Same thing with the Italians, what they did with tomatoes, cheese, and grains, pasta. They made like hundreds of different dishes out of exactly the same constituents that they had. And the meals are actually different when you eat them. And this is a part of the European genius on a lower level, you know, on a lower cultural level, but food is an important part we eat every day. And I began to see that. And over in America, everything you buy is just nothing but overwhelmingly with sugar. They make up for rich constituents with sugar. Most of the bakery goods come from Walmart, from the deli area of Walmart. And it's all sugary junk. You know, there's not a lot of eggs, there's not a lot of butter or creams in the stuff like over here, you know. I've been happy to see in traveling in Europe that people are still eating really good food. Even though some of the American fast foods have come in, they haven't overwhelmed the European people. I was really happy to see Disneyland falter in Paris because they had no business over here. I mean, those fantasy castles that Disney built, at Disneyland in America, they were copied from Bavaria, from King Ludwig's castles, basically. I mean, Europeans don't need comic book castles over here. You got the real thing, you know. So that's the problem. I know the immigration and everything in a government which is treating its own people like colonists, essentially. They want to, like what they did to native peoples in America and Oceania and everything, take away all symbols, all native religion, make everybody wear a suit and a tie just like a Westerner and so forth. And now they're using those same tactics against our own people. The British were really great at that. After they conquered Scotland for the last time, they made it a crime to play a bagpipe or a fiddle. In Ireland, if you had a harp, you could be hung for it, because the harp was a symbol of Celtic culture there, you know. And you couldn't wear a kilt in Scotland during the period, you know, it was outlawed. Anything that was a manifestation of your identity was to be taken away from you. And this is what they did worldwide, you know, to colonies. And now this is being applied to us. You know, they're trying to take away the last vestiges of what culture we have as to who we are. And we're just, they want us to be just these interchangeable units on a world grid, a world plantation, where they could take you from here, we need somebody to work here, somebody here, you know, and break everything up, mix us all together, and radically hybridized human beings of like widely different races. They usually have a war going on inside of them, and then they externalize it. They hate the world around them. Mild hybridization is good. A mild hybridization of mixing of European people is not bad. It kind of revitalizes things. You get a more energetic offspring from it for a couple of generations, and you break up any inbreeding factors that might occur because people are stuck in one locality for so many centuries, and you're bound to all end up being cousins sooner or later. That happened in Appalachia in America, in the mountain areas, you know, where people kept marrying first cousins and second cousins, and pretty soon everybody there has got the same surname. And then the highway system came in and everybody owned cars and travel, and then people began to leave those areas and find other people to breed with. And usually in one generation, you know, it breaks up all the inbreeding and you have totally healthy offspring. You know, whatever inbreeding factors were there that were in any way degenerating the people, they were revitalized again. Usually one fella told me about an Appalachian white man from Kentucky, and he lived like your typical, what they call hillbilly. He lived in a trailer house with a bunch of car wrecks all around his house, and he married a Polish lady. And the two daughters they have were stunningly beautiful. They went on to doctorates at the university, and they were these totally healthy people, and he had all the signs of inbreeding, the father, you know. But just that one time, mildly marrying out of all those lines that for 200 years had been crisscrossing and everything, they spawned some, you know, beautiful, intelligent offspring, and it revitalized them. So mild hybridization among Europeans is not a bad thing. I mean, I see that all the time in America. You know, Polish marry Italians, Italians marry Irish, Irish Germans. I mean, there's no big problem with that. You know, most Americans have five or six different European antecedents to them, you know. And there's no problem with that. In fact, that's probably why the American people were an energized people on the frontier in that, is because they broke up all of the inbreeding patterns, and it kind of revitalized them and gave them an extra surge. Everyone knows that hybridization in animal husbandry and everything, for the first generation or two, you get an offspring that's better than either of the parents, like in cattle. You get the right combination of cattle breeding, you get a bigger cow that gives more milk and everything. It only lasts for a generation or two, and then you gotta hybridize again to get the effects, you know, once again and so forth. But that's what America's like, you know, it's a hybridized, but it's largely hybridized of Indo-Europeans, you know, not too far apart. And as the geneticists claim, we are all descended from seven mothers in the Pyrenees, in Neolithic periods. The gene studies, genetic studies that were being done out of Oxford. There's a book on it called The Seven Daughters of Eve, and it's about these seven women whose remains they found. And every one of us here, if they do a genetic thing on our genetic chain, you will find it leads back to these seven women. Now, that we could be so variant as individuals in our looks, our height, our weight, all these other things is amazing, considering that we're essentially out of these seven women. Something tells me that in the Ice Age, that our numbers were radically cut back due to environmental factors. You know, there probably wasn't that many human beings left in the Ice Age. And we had 10,000 years of the Ice Age. And that, in many aspects, impressed itself upon who we are today. Our predilection for monogamy, one man, one woman, comes out of the Stone Age, out of the glacier period. Because in a glacier period, in an Ice Age, you just do not have time for bothering with soap opera affairs. I mean, you gotta get out every day and eat. You gotta get out and hunt. And not a lot of time for nonsense, you know. It's a thing of survival on a daily basis. And I think that's why we are the people of the wristwatch. Always watching the watch, time. We're obsessed with time. We have a chronos complex. You've all gotta be here at this time, gotta be there at that time. And I think that goes back to our Ice Age experience, that there's no time to sit around and waste, because you gotta get that firewood to keep the fires going. You gotta get that meat in to keep the internal fires going with you. You know, there's no sitting down on the job, you know, in an Ice Age. It's hunting, it's gathering, and it's surviving, basically, staying warm and staying fed. And so we became the people of the clock, of the wristwatch. You know, we're up. No people on Earth are obsessed with the time factor like we are. We are obsessed with two things, time and space. And that's why we set land car speed records, airplane records. That's the Faustian spirit. You know, always striving to overcome space in time. You know, that's our obsession. And it's the obsession that will take us to the stars if we can settle our affairs here on Earth in any measurable manner, so we're not bogged down here and all our resources are wasted. That's where our destiny is, out there. That's where we belong. That's where we need to go, to that big Ice Age in the sky. You know, maybe one day we'll slip through that black hole into the multiverse and find a whole new universe on the other side of it. But we're the people that'll do it. You know, we're the people with the drive and the desire and the abilities, the technical abilities in that. So that's the Faustian West. I mean, it's a good term. Oswald Spengler used that to typify the Western world. He called it Faustian culture, because it's a culture that's always striving, reaching for the stars. The whole space programs and everything that we've been engendered, mainly by Germans, were the primary people in the rocketry fields and everything. And like I said, I think the Western world died in 1945 for all practical purposes, with the end of World War II. All of the events that took place afterwards, like the landing on the moon and our space programs and all that, were just an extension of what existed and began before the end of the war. So it was nothing really new. It was just, we brought a whole bunch of scientists over to North America, and the Soviets took the rest of them there. And the two countries had space programs that were based upon these German aeroscientists, essentially, you know, without them. And now all of those scientists have died. You know, if any of them are alive, they're 90 or 100 years old. So ever since those German rocket scientists have retired, the American space program has just been an endless thing of looping around in this space shuttle. You know, we ain't going nowhere. It looks good, but it doesn't lead anywhere. You know, it's kind of redundant, kind of a monotony watching it, you know. So I guess we need more German rocket scientists to get going up there. Or
actually, German scientists were made in World War II when it wasn't.
Exactly. So, but what I'm saying is, I think Western civilization, for all practical purposes, died in 1945. And then somebody might say, oh no, it didn't die. We got to the moon, we did this, we did that. But if you check any of these things and follow them back, they all had their birthplace prior to the end of World War II. It was just an extension, you know, the reverberations and ripples across the years.
I'm sorry, but are you propagating the war?
In the war, as far as World War II was concerned, nobody won. Everybody lost.
In the name of the
we lost people. We lost people. America did not become great for winning World War II or Britain. Quite the contrary. You look at it today. There's the end product of it all. We had two world wars in the West, and they were much the same as Greece when they had the Peloponnesian War between Sparta and Athens and all the states that joined one side or the other. And they decimated each other. In 20 years, they killed off some of their best breed. Dysgenics set in. Macedonian marched in and took the whole place over easily because they were exhausted from 20 years of war. And World War I and World War II, in two segments, were our Peloponnesian War, basically. The West decimating itself, killing its own people. And when you look at that died in the two world wars, and these were probably some of the finest people went down in those wars, oftentimes young, who had never issued children, so they were, what's gone? They were gone forever. And then the stay-at-home people, who were not the best or the best military material, were the ones that bred and continued. So you go to England today, and it's like a country of small shopkeepers. At one time, this was an empire marching with proud, brave soldiers across the globe. And today it's like a second-rate place to go.
Do you believe what we're living right now is a phobia from a community coming together for a cause?
Is a phobia?
We're living a phobia. The community is living a phobia from the concept of living together for a cause. Whenever you talk about a cause. And that's actually what made the progress in the German, in that phase, with the German scientists.
Yeah.
Do you think we are living a phase of a phobia from what we went through before?
Like fearing doing it again.
I don't think we ever will. I don't think anything will ever go in the same direction as it did in World War II again. We have become older as a people, more sophisticated, and it was a much simpler world in pre-World War II. The people were much simpler in their outlook on life. We've seen a lot more history in our time and can look back to those lessons that were learned of extreme and overdoing things and so forth, you know, having good control over things and not letting things get out of hand or going wild. But I don't know where it'll end, you know. I sometimes see all the problems one day some catalyst is going to occur, some one single event, and it's going to be the thing that galvanizes everything all at once, just like when the Archduke of Austria was assassinated. Now, who cared about the Archduke of Austria? I wouldn't have even cared about him very much. I didn't know him. And he was assassinated, and then we had a world war as a consequence of this one single catalytic event, you know.
Do you believe that in our time, this kind of small event could catalyze catastrophic...
Yeah, I mean, something could happen one day in some city, some horrendous act would be perpetrated or something, and that would be like the straw that broke the camel's back. One more straw.
Really?
And everybody just rise up, you know, it would be suddenly, everybody's eyes would open. You know, it'd be like the writing on the wall, you know, this is what's happening. You know, suddenly all the people wake up out of their television sets. That could happen, you know. A good example of single events that could have long-reaching consequences, the assassination of John F. Kennedy. Essentially, it was a coup d'etat. A group of people took over America who are still running it, and from Lyndon Johnson right down to the present. And Lyndon Johnson was implicated as one of the people that set up the assassination. And that was a coup d'etat. You know, it's like a group took over the U.S. government by way of one assassination. It was more than just a murder of a president. It was a coup d'etat, a government change, a change of the people running things. And since that time, it's just been downhill. And you have the American imperialist thing of wanting to run the whole world, be the policeman of the world, attack every country they can find any excuse to get at the resources. Like all of the stuff that was going on in Bosnia. The one thing they never told you about, that Bosnia, that area, has the largest concentration of lead in the world. It's a very, very dense lead mine. And lead is what is used in submarine batteries and so many other things. And there's enough anthracite coal in Yugoslavia to heat the entire world for, I think, the next 300 years or something. So that area was really rich in natural things. So there was America, you know, getting right in there so they could get at that stuff. Yeah, I'm already done. There were just questions. I'm out of here.